the time. But when I got there, I met Kenneth and then found out that, so I came from Life Center. You guys know Life Center in Harrisburg? One of the worship pastors there, Ricardo White, this is his godson, and did not know that when I moved to the church that I moved to in Texas. He didn't know me, I didn't know him, and then we just got to be friends there. But Kenneth is amazing. He studied at Berkeley. He's an amazing musician. My favorite story to tell is that he was a backup singer for Stevie Wonder. How many of you know Stevie Wonder? On this last tour, was it the most recent? It was the most recent tour. That's my favorite one to tell. But probably the thing that Jesus loves the most about Kenneth is his willingness to serve everywhere, anywhere, and everywhere. So Kenneth actually works with a ministry called Star of Hope Ministries in Houston, Texas. And can you tell a little bit more about Star of Hope?
So Star of Hope is a faith-based ministry in the city of Houston. It's the largest organization, faith organization in Houston. We have four recovery centers, shelters in the city of Houston. And I oversee all of the outreach of the organization. So every individual who will never come to our facilities, we have a mobile outreach van that I'm over, and we go out under the bridges, in the encampments, in the woods, all over the city of Houston and surrounding areas, and we give the love of Jesus, the gospel of Jesus, and we also provide with permanent supportive housing. So I go from Houston to Washington, D.C. a lot because we work with the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development as we're providing permanent supportive housing for those who are have experienced chronic homelessness and deal with some type of disabling condition. And so I shared a little bit of my story yesterday, my testimony, but I was, you know, touring and doing all of that, and the Lord grabbed me an incredible encounter where I found my brother who was homeless 5 years ago, and the Lord radically changed my entire life. Randomly found him. I was walking the streets of Houston on a random Wednesday, October the 29th, and ran into my brother who I had not seen in over 10 years. I thought he was dead, and that's kind of what we had peace in our heart about, and saw him, and when I saw him, this is kind of crazy, but I collapsed and it was just like it's like your world just went upside down. And so that he brought him in, took him through the cycle of recovery for 2 years. He went from 9 attempts to suicide, heroin, crystal meth, prostitution, to actually praying and teaching Bible study 2 years in his first time in his life. So, miracle, you know. Out of 10 years of prostitution, not one STD or HIV, which is a miracle. So the Lord has just really, the Lord used my brother to open the door for me to share the gospel to the city of Houston. Had no idea that was coming my way. So the Lord is so good. I was sharing with Terry and Jeff, you know, this weekend how the Lord, you know, through my journey, you know, of understanding, like, man, why would you take me through this? Like, why am I going from here to here to here to here? You know, he was sharing that I was on tour with Stevie, which is great, but, you know, I would leave tour, come home and work and be under the bridge and go back on a tour and come home and be under another bridge. And one of my guys would say, hey, man, how was your weekend? And I said, well, you know, you wouldn't kind of believe it, but, you know, I actually was with Stevie Wonder yesterday. And he's like, dude, I think you need to be on the same vacation that I am because you kind of crazy. I said, there might be so. Hilarious, right? So, but through that journey, I just realized how the Lord kind of was showing me that there really isn't a dividing line between poverty and wealth. You know, the Lord has called us all to love, right? You know, he's commissioned us, the Great Commission. I mean, that's what he's given us. So it's an honor to be here and to be a part of what you guys are doing. It's actually encourages me and gives me confirmation that the Lord is really using us all, you know, to bring his men, kind of the spirit of Elijah, bringing fathers back to the children back to the fathers, you know. So awesome. Yeah.
Hallelujah. Well, we're so happy to have both of you guys. Texans, y'all. So we're really blessed to have a lot of great men of God today. In fact, it's my blessing to be able to take up the offering this morning. We're taking turns blessing the Lord and blessing the Lord in our giving. Now, I know that for some reason, I hope this isn't true for you. I found that I'm finally caught up with my wife's generosity, but that took a lot of time because my wife has a checkbook anointing. She can write a check in literally 2.5 seconds, the whole thing filled out. So we have a prophetic game we play. We see, and the nice thing is usually we get the exact same number. We just pray when we're going to give. Everything in your life should be prophetic. Everything in your life should be like challenging you to hear God. Because if it's not challenging you to hear God, what's it challenging you for or toward? What's your life all about? So our giving is the opportunity to trust, and our giving is the opportunity to hear. And so when we use it for what it's for, it also brings great breakthroughs for us because we step into favor, we step into the anointing. I tell this story a lot since there's a lot of new faces in the room about when my wife and I got married. When we got married, that's peculiar. I just started a computer job. I was making about $31,000 a year. And so my salary is $31,000. So about $18 an hour. She's making about $10.50 an hour. I want to shortchange her. And so together we were just at about $50,000 a year, if that. And we started learning about giving. And started learning about sowing, and started learning about stretching, started learning about believing. And within about 6 years, I always give a year in case I'm wrong, but it was at 5 or 6 years, we went from making $50,000 a year to giving $50,000 a year because we were under training that stretched us. Some people just got offended. I got blessed. So if you've ever been under teachings that have offended you, it's good to be offended. In fact, Jesus says it this way. Offenses will come, period. Or comma. No, he has a comma. But woe to those in whom they come. So what's he saying? He's saying, you know, you're going to get challenged. The question is, are you going to stay and let it go into offense? Or are you going to let yourself grow in the supernatural, grow in the spirit, grow in who you are in the Lord? So I challenge each one of you that are here to really just ask the Lord what you'd have to do, Lord, in this place. We just thank you for every giver, every lover of you. And I thank you, Lord, for every person that partners. And I thank you, Lord, for our breakfast. I thank you for all those good things. But most of all, I thank you, Lord, that I can trust in you. You weren't after Isaac. You were after me learning to trust. And he took me up on a mountain and you showed me the ram in the thicket. And I found out that you're the Lord who provides. You know, I don't know how many times you got to go through the challenge where your finances seem like they're just not enough. But here's what I'm going to tell you. If you'll just walk up the hill knowing that God will provide, you'll see that he's always, 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 always faithful. I don't know how to say it any better than that. The Lord is so good to us in regards to our finances. And we need to learn to trust, because when we trust, we can prepare our hearts for more. When we can learn to be open vessels, when we can learn to pour the blessings through, God can get it to us. And so he never wants to put more on you than you can bear. How many people don't want yourself to not be able to bear finances? You know, I want to be able to bear the load of the glory. I want to be able to bear the load of his blessing. I want to be able to bear the load of the anointing. And those things are dangerous if you're not ready for them. So challenge yourself right now. Challenge yourself right now. Let's all the men stand up. If you need an envelope because you don't, you want to give with a credit card, that's fine. There's actually a credit card slot on there. This is going to go to our speakers, Kenyon Southers is speaking this morning. We want to bless him. Can y'all put your hands together for Bishop Kenyon Southers? He's got a radical church in Baltimore, and I got to speak at his place. I got to hear him at the Cave, and you know, I'm glad that he's connected with us today. It's going to be a great day. So let's bless the Lord, everyone. Bless the Lord, mighty ones. Bless the Lord with us together as we give unto the Lord and big thanksgiving hearts. Amen. In Jesus' name, be released. Thank you, Pro Team. Hallelujah. Hey. That's just jam.
I see the smoke on the horizon. I feel my heart pounding in my chest. I hear the war raging all around me, but somehow I feel like I was born for this. I can taste the fear, the angel's courage, as I raise my shield and lift my sword.
You know, it's cool. It's cool to live for Jesus. I think that at one time I got this revelation, you know, my God shall supply all of my needs according to his riches and glory. You know, the thing is, sometimes we aren't real willing to stretch out outside. And Kenneth, I pray that the Lord continues to stretch not just your heart, but your life so that it would encompass and you would stretch out beyond your measure, because you're going to believe God in such a way that's going to push you past what seems possible to the place of impossibility has to fill. The grace is going to have to fill the slot where your faith stretched you out to. And I believe that if you'll learn to stretch out for the Lord is going to backfill everything that was lacking in your life, because my God shall supply all of my needs. My needs are met, and the more I stretch, the more he fills. See, a lot of times we look at what we have and figure out what to do or what to give and how to stretch, but instead, God doesn't do it that way. He says, I want you to stretch, and then I'm going to fill. I want you to release, and I'm going to give. And you're like, that doesn't make any sense. That's why he's God and I'm man. That's why he's the Lord. You know, I just challenge men, because we get pigeonholed into logic. We get pigeonholed. Everybody in here is all different. I get that. But we get pigeonholed the most in logic. And we want God to be linear. And he's kind of linear. If you take plots and figure out he's here, and why is that over there? Okay, that's up there. And that's over there. And then God says, it's perfectly linear. And he just takes the marker and goes, because I feel all in all. And he just makes the largest line across the universe and say, the dots were straight to me. And just, so we're about to, let's go ahead and pray in faith, Father, right now. God, I thank you for blessing men of God that know how to trust, know how to hear. And I thank you, Lord, for this conference. I thank you, Lord, for relationships, divine appointments. And, Lord, I thank you for prophetic release. We just stir up the gift of God, which is on the inside of us. And we thank you for financial gifts as well, Lord. We ask as we lift these up, Lord, they will bless every speaker. They will bless every giver. They will release your kingdom. And Father, I just thank you for partnership with heaven. God, it is our privilege in the name of Jesus to align with you and to give you praise. Thank you for being our God. In Jesus' name we thank you. Amen. 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 You know, I came from some crazy stuff. Sometimes I tell my story. I lived in Baltimore City on by Fulton and McHenry. If you don't know where that is, I usually just tell people Pratt Street and Fulton Avenue or Pratt Street and Monroe. And it was so bad. Like my little block, my one block with however many, 15 row houses on my side, 15 row houses on that side. We had about 6 or 8 boarded up just on my little teeny block, right? And then we had another block right up. And so people, they call them a bandominium. So we have our dope addicts that like to have a little place to hang out. Every once in a while, if there's still copper left in the building, they like to borrow or steal the copper out of the houses. Well, the problem with stealing the copper is that the valves usually are involved. So that poor house decides to leak in everybody else's house. And so they just pull the copper off the walls, which means all the water from that unit just starts filling up. And I had a guy I was helping one time. He says, "Can you turn off the water?" And I was like, "I guess, he was in Pennsylvania." I started making friends with some of the slum lords. And I got some bags on my feet to get in the water. And I realized, like, all the water was coming over the electric panel into the water. And I was like, well, it sounded like a good idea until I see, like, this little Niagara Falls going over an electric panel. I was like, as an electrician, this is a bad idea. So my life was very backwards. You know, I went without electricity for months. I went without water for months. I've experienced some low places, and it's caused me not to be hard of heart, but to be tender, to see what the Lord's delivered me from. And men, you really don't know why you went through all the hardships you went through until you realize the glory that's to be revealed. And if you don't ever find the glory on the other side, you're going to just sit there wondering, well, what exactly did I have to go through that for? Because there's some glory to be revealed. One of my favorite scriptures when you're going through a hard time is to remember that what you're going through is not worthy to be compared to what the glory that's being revealed. The Bible says these momentary light afflictions. You don't know what I'm going through. They're not momentary or light. It's been a long time. And then you look at Paul's life. Well, the guy who's saying it has his resume on doctorate. It's right there in scripture. Like, you know, I've been whipped by 39 times, 3 times. I got whipped 3 times like Jesus. I got beat with rods. I was shipwrecked, left for dead. I was stoned and they rolled me over the hill, thought I was dead, so they got rid of me. I woke up beaten, bruised, battered. Stoned to death with rocks. Thrown over the hill. And then he says, so these momentary light afflictions are not worthy to be compared to the glory that's going to be revealed. Now, whatever you're going through, if you start looking at Paul's life, you'd be like, yeah, I'm good. God's good. So I just challenge you guys to stir up your faith regards to that. And let's get ready. Let's put your hands on your ears and say, Lord, I have ears to hear.